Okay, so now we're ready to look at the connection between those equilibria that we saw in the previous lesson. We take reactants or reactants and products and we let them go back and forth till their rates of the forward and rates of the reverse reaction are exactly equal, and we've established this dynamic equilibrium. There's going to be something that we have in common. I forgot to grab my remote, so let's grab the remote here. Okay, so there's the three we left off with, okay, and we see that at some point we reach equilibrium, but we also see that the amount of reactants and products is not the same in each. It's not like it goes to the same concentration of N2O4 and NO2 in every case. So it doesn't look like they have a connection, but there is one, and it's called the equilibrium constant, with emphasis on the word constant, right? We're going to look at a way of having you be able to construct your own mathematical relationship between the concentrations of things in there. This is called the law of mass action, but very often I will call it the equilibrium constant expression, because that's what I grew up. That's what I've taught it as many times, but it's also called the law of mass action in some books. Okay, so here is our reaction. Notice the equilibrium arrows. The back and forth arrows of our equilibrium always give away that we're dealing with a equilibrium in the case. So to construct K, this equilibrium constant, what you do is this expression, okay, which is law of mass action, or the equilibrium constant expression, as I like to call it. Now what sits up on the top? Okay, what's up there on the top? Well, it's the products. Let's get the word here. Equilibrium constant, let's mention that this is a dimensionless quantity. It doesn't have units. Now, you put units in, correct units, on the right-hand side, and that's essential, and things are not going to completely cancel out to leave you no units the way we look at it. If you take upper-level chemistry classes, you're going to find what really happens to those units. But here's the one place where you make sure you put them in the equation correctly, but when it's all said and done, K, the equilibrium constant, in this case, has no units. Now that was not the case when we were dealing with rate laws. When we were dealing with rate laws, we were dealing with a lowercase k, and those did have units. You had a 1 over seconds, you had 1 over molarity times seconds, you had various units for that. But here we have no units. So the square brackets, we get used to that representing molarity. It's its concentration in molarity, or moles per liter. Whoops. So what we have here is up on the top, the way I like to say this, and I will say it over and over again, that the equilibrium constant expression is the products, C-T-S, that says products, over the reactants. Right? We have the products on top over the reactants raised to the power of their coefficients. Now, here is what that says, coefficients. It's not writing very well. See if I can get it to write. All right. Raised to the power of the coefficients. Remember when we were dealing with rates, and we were dealing with the rate laws, we couldn't use the coefficients as powers because we had to experimentally determine what those powers or orders were. Here, you do raise them to the power. So you see the lowercase c, the lowercase d, the lowercase a, the lowercase b coming into play there. So for all of these, while they don't look like they have the same anything in common, what would be the law of mass action for this reaction? Okay, write that down in your notes. Law of mass action would be the equilibrium constant is equal to the concentration of NO2 squared divided by the concentration of N2O4. And you might say, well, this is a reversible reaction. How do I know which is my reactants or which is my products? This expression has to be paired with the way you write the reaction. So if we choose to write the reaction this way, this is its K expression. Okay, so that would be its law of mass action. So what does that mean? That means that once I get to equilibrium, if I had a way of measuring the NO2 concentration and the N2O4 concentration, and I were to plug them in here and here, I would get a constant out every time. So you can make a measurement of those equilibriums, you can plug the values in. So while it doesn't look like they have much in common when I look at them, the reality is if I took the NO2 concentration that it obtained at equilibrium and squared it, and divided by the concentration of N2O4 it has on the bottom, I would always get the same number out within experimental error. All right, now let's think about what this K tells me about the reaction. So you're going to go through a series of questions here to answer. It is all based upon this same equilibrium constant expression, which I have written at the top of your slide there. And I'm telling you what the value is. Okay, somebody went and made the measurements at equilibrium and they obtained this value of 4.63 times 10 to the minus 3. And again, it's unitless. Okay, so let's think about which one of those has to be true when you have a K that's really small, much, much less than 1. Now, if it's equals 1, that means my numerator and my denominator are exactly the same, right? What if it's much less than 1? Which one of those would be true? Well, it would have to be that the denominator is big and the numerator is small, because that would give you a fraction, right? It'd give you a number less than 1. So if that is true, whenever K is small, that has to be true because of math. Which one of these would be true? Remembering this statement here. Well, if it's much less than 1, we know the denominator's got to be the big number. What sits in the denominator? Products over reactants. So there are more reactants at equilibrium than there are products. That's what the magnitude of K will tell me when it is small. Here's a different reaction, okay? Look at that reaction and look at the value of K. It's not small, it's large. It is bigger than 1, so which one of those statements has to be true when K is large? Well, certainly when K is large, the top has to be big. What sits up there at the top? Which one of those things sits at the top? What can you say about a large K? Well, what sits on the top are products. So you're going to have more products at equilibrium. That's one of the things that K will tell you. You got to get used to that. Not only in this class, but if you take organic chemistry, if you take biochemistry, they will deal with these equilibrium constants often, and they tell you something about the equilibrium. What is in there? What do you have more of once it's established equilibrium? Okay, so if we look back at this reaction, the question is, we had a small value, right? That's 4.63 times 10 minus 3. In this, regardless of what you started with, in this reaction, do we end up having more N2O4 at equilibrium than we have NO2? Well, certainly yes. The blue, the N2O4, is above the other. It doesn't tell you how much more, okay? It just tells you there is more and that the ratio would always give you this number out. So we will eventually be able to use that in calculations, but for right now, what I expect you to be able to do is, if you know equilibrium concentrations, you can write the expression and obtain a value for this number. Not that hard to do, okay? We'll be doing it from time to time as we work our way through these lessons. So, what we need to be able to do next, and I'll just give you a precursor to that, is remember I said that when you write this expression, it applies to a very specific way of writing the reaction? If you go and do manipulations to that reaction, you need to make sure you can manipulate your K value correctly. So that's what's up next for us.